All right, hey, greetings each and every last one of you, sweet presses, the strong and victorious and mighty overcoming name of our soon coming King, Yahshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. I hope that you all are doing well. I'm drinking cold coffee just about. All right, that's neither here nor say. I'll go over here and drink water. I hope that y'all are doing well, each and every last one of you. I don't have the actual chat board up here right now, which I can probably do. Let me see about getting this other chat board up here just for a second. Yeah, that's that chat. I'm talking about the online chat. All right. Got a few things I want to talk to us about. Should be very interesting here tonight. The new picture, far as on the website, the Feast of Tabernacles, it's up. It really truly is. It's up now. Straight with you, radio. Hope I don't double. All I can do is pause that player. Yeah. Well, I just got two of them. Stop. All right. Hey, it looks good in there. 62 people there in the chat room. All right, that's good enough. I get out of that screen right now. I pulled out too much bandwidth. All right, Israel. Hey, I hope that y'all are doing well and that each and every last one of you blessed. What we're going to do is talk here just for a moment after we get everything settled in here just for a second. You know, We do have a P.O. Box address. It's called a P.O. Box 32. It's P.O. Box 32, Lafayette, L-A-F-A-Y-E-T-T-E, Tennessee, 37083. We're still using a P.M. Box. It's just that we are diversifying because we live in uncertain times, but so we're diversifying. If you need to mail anything to us by way of UPS, FedEx, DHL or whatever, you would have to mail it to 506 Ellington Drive. 506 Ellington Drive, then you have to include P.O. Box 32, Lafayette, Tennessee, and that's spelled L-A-F-A-Y-E-T-T-E, Tennessee 37083. And then it would actually get to us here at Straightway. You know, I'm going to read us something here, and I'm going to talk to you just for a second because I noticed a lot of people are seeing a lot of edification, a lot of exhortation, a lot of comfort from scripture study, even though it's kind of hard-hitting. You know, anytime you talk about things that we all are dealing with, you're going to be impacted. There's going to be very, very few people that is ever truly going to be exempt from any of those messages whatsoever at all because their message is designed to actually to perfect us. And most people, and I hope that you are listening to me, most people are really, truly not interested in the sanctification process. While I do not believe that we here at Straightway are better than anybody, there is something to say for those of us who have had tenure in this and have been after this sanctification process for a very long time. I'm talking about people who have been in the ministry, let's say 7+ years. You know, there's a difference now. There's a couple of people that are on steroids, if I can use that and be pure, that are actually growing at breakneck speed. But the majority of the people in the ministry, I see growth, but I still see a lot of carnality. I really, truly do, which is actually disheartening considering the amount of information that this ministry puts out and the amount of information that this ministry gives. To much is given, much is required. And no doubt we are given much, so therefore much is required. Glory to the King. Hallelujah. Now, I got a little short something I'm going to talk about here just for a moment. And I want you to kind of comprehend here, okay, just for a second. I'm going to read something here. I want you to listen very closely, all right? Most Israelites claim to be obedient to Yah. They claim to be righteous, to follow the leading of the Ruach HaKodesh, and to be servants of Yah. However, determine who a person's Yah is rather simple. You just need to observe whom they obey. Scripturally, we are told that, know ye not that whomsoever, to whom you present yourselves as servants unto obedience, his servants ye are to whom you obey, whether sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. And that's Romans 6:16. The first thing to notice is that there are no servants unto obedience or obedient servants, which imply that they are disobedient servants. Obedient servants attain unto righteousness. Now, you understand that anytime that you obey, the ideal is to obtain to righteousness. You remember Noah, Daniel, and Job? Noah, Daniel, and Job were people who were, if they were in a certain generation, all right, they would deliver neither son nor daughter, but they would but just save themselves. And that's pretty much where we're at today. And the way that they would save themselves is by their own righteousness. And that's how that they would deliver their soul. And righteousness mostly comes by obedient to the word, to the law, to the word of the Most High Yah, which most people are having a very difficult time doing, because the fleshly nature commands and demands so much. Most people just simply not interested in being sanctified and being holy. But make no mistake about it. If righteousness is what delivered Noah, Daniel, and Job, righteousness will be the very thing that would deliver us in this generation. And remember, I have seen righteousness before thee in this generation. All right, the righteous are righteous because they are obedient, and the unrighteous are unrighteous because they are disobedient. The conclusion is that unrighteous are sinners, which bring us to the need to define sin. Now, we all know sin, according to 1 John 3:4, is the transgression of the law. Now, that's what we have to really, truly hone in on this thing and really, truly try to put our sight, you know what I mean, get our sight honed in real, real good. If we were standing in front of the Most High Yah right now, what would he say to each one of us? And no doubt about it, some of the things you know that he would say. Because the heart knows its own bitterness. And it's going to take that type of scrutiny for all of us to be able to look at ourselves, to be able to determine and understand where we're going to be at concerning the kingdom. Because there's no way that the Most High is going to tolerate disobedience in his kingdom. But you understand that the King of Kings, the Masters of Masters, is a very serious Elohim. Do y'all really truly comprehend that? Do you get it? That means he's not going to tolerate toying around, playing around. And you can tell what he tolerated and what he didn't tolerate by the way he handled himself in the Torah. Can you imagine today how many people, how many of us would literally be dead who champion ourselves as Torah observers or law keepers? I mean, you may not be picking up sticks on the Sabbath, but what else are you doing on the Sabbath? You know what the scripture says, that you shouldn't bring in no unnecessary burden into the temple on the Sabbath day? Now, you are the temple of Yah. Man, some of you come into Shabbat burden. It's a sad situation. And we actually believe that the Most High Yah is going to continue to keep tolerating us with that, because Christianity has graced us half to death. That we actually believe that it's called that. You remember some time ago I talked about Antinomianism? Remember that? Where you actually really truly, you know, you believe that God means what he says and says what he means and stuff, but it's really not for you today. And that's how people function. And I'm trying my best because we had such a wonderful Sukkot, and that Sukkot came because we had righteous people here. We had people who were serious-minded about the Most High Yah. And I'm trying my best to constantly seek when I get the opportunity, and I'm getting the opportunity because I make the opportunity, when I seek the Most High Yah, because that's one thing, brothers and sisters, that just simply cannot be relaxed in any of our lives, is our personal time with the Most High Yah. You can't allow anything to interfere with that, because when it's all said and done, it ain't going to be nobody but you and him, and he's going to be the one who's judging you. And you need that in order to make sure that you have a right attitude and that you adjust your spirit in order to fit what the scripture says, so that when he comes, he'll be happy when he sees you. But can you imagine going out, picking up sticks on the Shabbat, and then all of a sudden you see people die today? How many people would die today on the Sabbath for merely breaking the law? How many people do you know, huh? Think about that for a second. Or what about, let's go into the Torah here. You know, there seems to be a hot topic or topic of conversation today. You know, it's obvious that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was Joseph's either second or third wife, because Jesus had stepbrothers. And of course, when we hear stuff like that, we equate it to our mindset and the society we find ourselves immersed in and surrounded by today. We automatically think that that was just Joseph Long's wife was Mary, but that's not so. It's just like we think that when we read the nativity scene, that's what they call it today in Christianity, the nativity scene, when it says that there's no room in the inn. First of all, there was no inn back then. You mean there was no room in the house? And the reason why there was no room in the house is because Joseph's wife, his principal wife, and their children were there. And so when she went to be out into the Sukkot, or the Sukkah, excuse me, in the Sukkah, we automatically assumed that there was no room in Motel 6 today. And so they had to actually, because it was during the time of the Feast of Tabernacles, that Mary just stayed in a Sukkah because there was no room in the hotel. Bad translation. And of course, you can't expect Orthodox, or you can't expect Christianity, you can't even expect much Messianics, and definitely Israelites today, to actually tell you the painful truth on a lot of things, because it's just simply too painful to entertain a Western mindset that has been manipulated and coerced and believe it actually thinks soundly and functions soundly and lives soundly and thinks rationally, when all our thoughts are pretty much defiled nowadays and way, way, way out of order and out of perspective according to what the scripture teaches us and tells us. But it's really a sad, sad situation. So, Mary was more like Joseph's second or third wife at that particular time. That's just bottom line, all there is to it. And you have to understand, when you read Josephus, and a lot of Hebraic history and stuff, it was just part of our culture to be in polygyny. Now, polygyny is very difficult in the day that we're living in now, because the people don't think after Hebrew thought. They still wrestle after the Western mindset, and this Western mindset, it brings a challenge to actually Eastern thought. But nevertheless, the bottom line, can you imagine today somebody murmuring against the custodian of the law, Moshe himself? Can you imagine that? And you knew which one who was guilty and who was doing the murmuring, and the one who was just sitting there like castrated Ahab. It was Miriam that did the most murmuring. How do we know that? Because she was the one that was smitten with leprosy. And chances are the reason why Haran didn't get it, because he probably just sit there and let her run her mouth, and which is a sad, sad thing. And so she got shut outside the camp. And you know what else I bring out today about Miriam? There is nothing that tells her that her skin actually turned back to color from white. It's just all there's to it. And so chances are she probably died in that state and that condition and stuff, but the leprosy she was healed from. Think about that for a second. And of course, now today, you know, we're dealing with demonic spirits. Now, we know that they dealt with devils or satyrs. That's what they were called in the Hebrew then. In the Greek New Testament, they are deamanze or demons, or deamanzo. They are called demons now, which is nothing more than devils or disembodied spirits. And of course, when you read books of the Apocrypha, you read the book of Enoch, You know, it's kind of hard for us in our modern mindset to wrap our minds around some of these accounts that was taking place because they're far stretched from us because, you know, we're not too much familiar with the supernatural nowadays. We're just simply not because we're just natural, earthly, sensual, carnal. And it's hard for us to do this now unless, and that's why I say over and over again, you have to actually set yourself apart, literally. And the more you set yourself apart, the stranger you're going to be to people in this land. You're going to be even a stranger amongst your own people. And that's a sad situation. And it's a sad indictment given today. But you won't be alone because the Messiah will be with you. So my admonishment is to strive to enter into the straight gate. So let's go on here for a second. Let's talk about what I was going to deal with. You know, the subject explained in detail, and check it out, it's called the law of nature, all right? And we're going to go ahead and go over a few things that has been prescribed. In Dabarim 4:2, it says, you shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish it. You understand that? You don't add to it. In other words, you don't assert your own opinion, your own ideal, your own philosophy, or your own theology. You don't do any of that. You don't add to it, or do you take away from it? And then it says in Tehillim 19:7, for the law of Yahweh is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of Yah is sure, making wise the simple. So nothing can be added to or taken away which is perfect. Now, that which is perfect cannot be improved upon. If man or government makes laws, then he does so in direct, look at this, contravention of Yah's word and at the direction of evil ones. In other words, if you exalt your opinion above Yah's word, then you're not being influenced by your own mind. You're being influenced under the influence of satyrs or devils or demonze, which are demons, if you understand what I mean, and not Yah. Therefore, the laws of man are the laws of Babylon or Mammon and not Yah. So we live in a world today where we have more fear of the laws of man than we do the laws of Yah. Now, let me go back to the so-called quote-unquote nativity scene. You think about this scene for a second, okay? Because in that nativity scene, it makes you wonder why, if they was there during the Feast of Sukkot or Tabernacles, it makes you wonder why come there was no room in the house when they all, Israelites, should have been in booths. You know what I mean? They should have been in booths or they should have been in sukkahs. So why were they in the house? I'll tell you the reason why they were in the house. Because they were Hellenized. They were Hellenized by a culture called the Roman culture. And remember, the northern tribes of Israel received a divorce from the Most High Yah, and he put them away legally by divine fiat, by giving them a bill of divorce because of their worshiping of other Elohims or mighty ones. And he was simply just not going to tolerate that. So when Yahshua came and said, I've not been sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel, he was sent to his people. And his people didn't know him because they had been so immersed and so Hellenized in the Greco-Roman society. Kind of reminds you of today, don't it? Anytime you start talking about the real salvation, Yahshua. Anytime you start talking about him, people are so steeped in the witchcraft, so steeped in the paganism, so steeped in the satanic worship. When you start talking about this real Messiah today and stuff, it's kind of like back then. We've been Americanized and they've been Hellenized and all of us have been Greekanized. And every single one of us, whether we like it, comprehend it, understand it or not, we still have these evil impressions and these evil influences up on our minds. And they greatly affect the way that we process thought. They greatly affect the way that we see things. They greatly affect the way that we discern things because we basically have been Americanized, Hellenized, and we think after that culture. Now, of course, that culture was responsible. Of course, it was the Jews who called themselves Yehudim of the day that murdered the Messiah. And when they murdered the Messiah, it didn't take long for the father to actually pay back those murders. And you think about some of these scathing indictments that was given to Yisrael at this particular time. And you think about this. I mean, you talking about some curses that was placed upon them. In 70 AD, the Roman general Titus actually sacked Jerusalem. Most people say, well, yeah, the Romans did that. But that was the judgment of Almighty Yah upon a nation. Because remember, Yahshua had told him, this day your house is left unto you desolate. Did you hear that? Desolate. He also said, when he went to this fig tree and the disciples was there with him, and said, look, there ain't nothing on this fig tree right here. And Yahshua cursed the fig tree. In other words, he cursed the Yehudim nations at that time, and no man will henceforth eat any fruit of this tree forever. Nobody's going the way of Judaism or Yehudim, these people who are immersed in satanic paganism. That goes for you too, Christianity, who try to trump the Israelite heritage and then try to do a replacement theology too. The Most High Yah is not going to coexist with foreign mighty ones or Elohims. He's not going to do that. Only him. He alone is the only true Yahweh. He alone is the only true power in the universe. And there is no other mighty one but him. And I said all this to say, because you really truly need to get this in your heart, and you really truly need to get this into your mind. We acknowledge that he alone is the only one, but when you watch us in our lifestyle, you watch us in the way we carry ourselves, you watch us in so-called conviction, we really truly do not have the fear of Yahweh in our hearts. No, we don't. I watch the lackadaisical attitude amongst us as a people, and we are just existing without the fear of the Most High in our lives on a daily basis. And we just truly not taking it as serious as we should. Resistance to tyranny. This brings us to the book, Resistance to Tyranny. All right. James 4:7 says, be subject therefore unto Yah, resist the devil, the false accuser, you know, the evil one, and he will flee. All right. This is a very interesting verse. Well, we subject ourselves to Yah, then we should be obedient to Yah. And this verse supports what we saw in Romans 6:16. If we do then that which, you know, we should, which is resist the devil, for resisting the devil is being obedient to Yah. You cannot resist the devil and being subject to, you cannot resist the devil by being subject to and obeying the devil. Resistance to the devil is resistance to also, watch this, not only tyrannical government that operates in your own mind, but tyrannical governments of this earth as well. It's a simple choice. So we have to ask ourselves, you know, who are we really, truly obeying today in this hour? Because, you know, the bottom line is, whosoever you yield your members' servants to obey, that is whose servants you will obey. Well, what legislation do you function after? Are you really, really, truly being transformed by the renewing of your mind? Are you really, truly dying out to self today? Are you really, truly being purged so you can actually go into that holy kingdom? Are you really? I can ask these questions all day long, but your conflict is not with flesh and blood. It's with angels. Demonic angels. It's with powers and rulers of this world. It's against the rulers of darkness of this world. It's against spiritual wickedness in high places. What's the highest place? Right here, your mind. On a daily basis, I experience very uncomfortable feelings when I can tell that the enemy is speaking through someone. How do you reach someone? How do you talk to them? How do you tell them that an evil spirit is speaking through them when they are quick to defend themselves from that actual evil spirit and insulate themselves? It's rough. And it's getting more tougher as the days go by, Israel. I said all this because, you know, the Bible teaches us to be sober, to be vigilant, because our adversary, the satyr, the devil, he's walking about as a roaring lion, and he's seeking whom he may devour. Wow, wow, wow. We have to save ourselves from his untoward generation. We really, truly do. I hope that y'all encouraged. I hope I said something to bring some type of edification, exhortation, and comfort. More than anything, I hope I said something that would actually bring about a soberness, more so, in your heart and in your mind, and that you will become more serious-minded and not let the experience of Tabernacles fade away from you because you're not here with the saints. We really, truly need to be sober. We really, really, truly do. Hallelujah. Glory to the King. The guest calling number is 310-982-4226. 310-982-4226. If you like to talk to Pastor Dow, what you do is you call the guest calling number, 310-982-4226. You'd like to ask a question, feel free to ask the question. I was listening to our sisters and sisters broadcast yesterday. Very edifying broadcast. It really truly is. Now, don't get me wrong, sisters. I'm not saying that you cannot call in on this broadcast. Never have said that. What I am saying is, you have a husband, what does the Bible tell you to do? The Bible says if you have a question, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to ask your husband at home. Is that what it says? If you are a married woman, you got a question, ask your husband. He don't know, then let him ask for you. What's wrong with that? You see, in this feminist society that we live in, most women today would take that as an insult. That's what it says. But if you're a single sister, you can call in and ask questions. Sure you can. Just don't run your mouth like you normally do when you're talking with other sisters. I don't want to hear all that. Get directly to the point, sisters, if you're going to call in. You know, you'll count it wise when you don't say too much. But some of you, you got to tell us about the wart that grew on your toenail and how that you was delivered from it 30 years ago and it came back again. I don't want to hear all that stuff. Just get to the point. It's just ridiculous the way our minds function today. And then most people just, they take an offense when you try to correct them. And you have to understand, Pastor Dow, I do not only preach the gospel, but I live it. And I have been living with saints for 20 years of my life. You've been living by yourself, or living with families, or living with relatives, or living with just your own immediate family. So you have no idea what it means to have iron that sharpens iron. You don't. So take heed to wise counsel, all right? Just do that, all right? And things will go well. The guest calling number is 310-982-4226. You like to ask Pastor Dow a question. This is the time, because many of you ask. I mean, I guess it's private. But, man, they ask me a lot of questions in email. Some I respond to, some I don't. But I'll tell you what, I really, truly enjoyed all the Israelite brethren at this Feast of Sukkot 2015. The best feast by far. They're all good, but this is the best one by far. And I think the reason why it's the best one by far is because we really, truly didn't have that much sin in our presence. That's right. All right, that's just the truth. All right, I tell you what. Let me go here to a radio break while I do not break tradition, and I actually go up here and see exactly what's going on up here in the room or the other chat room. Man, I gotta remove some of this stuff out of here. Well, man, hey, I want y'all to take out all these things, Pastor, with the Chad factor. Y'all brothers that's on the broadcast, remove that Chad factor stuff. Don't need that mess on there. I had somebody today, the other day, call themselves an officer. I think it's from the ISUPK, Israelite School of Practical Knowledge. I think is what it is. And an officer wanted to debate me on who Israel is. I told Elias, write him back, tell him we already know who Israel is. There's no need for debating. There's no discussion. And of course, an officer is kind of like just a regular saint. Now, you can tell these new religions because they got officers, captains. What else they got? Generals. What happened to apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers? What's wrong with that? Anyway, it's a sad thing, but that's what they want to talk about. Hey, that's what they want to do. Glory to the King. They go ahead and do what they want to do, but we're going to follow the straight and narrow way over here, all right? I can't find it. I'll tell you what. We'll get a little bit of Rule of Universe, and I'll be right back, all right? I'll be right back. Don't forget to push one.
So I'm a man of God. He says, tomorrow I want you in Africa, guess where I'm going to be at? If I want you in Germany tomorrow, guess where I'm going to be at? That's why I'm not reverend. I'm not pope. I'm not bishop. I'm not deacon. I'm not elder. That's why my name is Pastor Charles Dowell. There's a difference. You hear me, brother? There's a difference. And that's what's wrong with the church today. The reason why it's so powerless. Now see, the thing that God is going to deviate from his plan and from his book the way he has always done it, he ain't going to do it. Man is going to deviate, but God is not going to deviate. Jesus said, you come follow me. I know it. Everybody wonder what I'm doing too. I'm also getting that spirit too. Dealing with some curses. We're going to get a hold of that thing in a minute. Hey, can you bring her right here, brother? Put her right here so me and that spirit can have some altercations here. So anyway, I was surprised that the young man didn't get mad at me. And I told him, I said, brother, I'm sorry, brother. I knew when God had so-called, because we learned that terminology, called me to preach. I said, I knew what happened. The day he did that, brother, I was ready to leave. See how that spirit did? That's that spirit. Now, you remember how I told you that everybody here know that ain't her. We know that, don't you? You understand that, right?
Natural disaster. Civil unrest. Economic collapse. Don't depend on grocery stores or government handouts. Pastor Dal urges you to stock up on New Manna food storage. New Manna is swine-free, GMO-free, has no high fructose corn syrup or artificial flavors. New Manna's tasty meals are individually wrapped. Potato cheese casserole, pasta primavera, sweet habanero chili mac and cheese, and many more, secured in a reusable bucket with a shelf life of 25 years. New Manna's wholesome food storage will help you thrive no matter what. Just add boiling water and you'll have a delicious meal in minutes. Pastor Dal and Straightway Truth offer New Manna food storage at a very reasonable price. Click on the New Manna link at straightwaytruth.com. That's S-T-R-A-I-T, waytruth.com. Or call 615-688-3025. 615-688-3025. Order New Manna for your food security today.
Chax does a pretty good job. Some people just got them kind of radio voices and stuff. I don't have that kind of radio voice, man. My voice is just, I don't know, I guess it is what it is. I've been getting a lot of positive emails, a lot of positive feedback, though. I really, truly have. All right. All right. Remember when you called the guest calling number, you press number one. And once you press number one, then you'll be in a caller queue. But you have to wait till you hear the automated voice, okay? And then I will see a little sign that tells me that you want to talk to Pastor Dow. All right. Call number 716. 716, Brother Will, there in New York, New York, big city of dreams. Brother Will, how can I help you, son?
Hey, Shabbat Shalom, Pastor Dow. How are you, sir?
Doing well. Me and Elias been actually trying to finish the job that me and Brother Emmy started. We've been hanging sheetrock today and stuff, but you know, and everybody's busy as bees here on the community. But I'm doing well. How can I help you?
Hallelujah. Just calling in to thank you once again for having myself and Brother Cody come down for the feast. You know, say Shabbat Shalom to you, to all the brothers and sisters on the land. I want to thank them as well for all their hospitality. I want to thank the sisters for the food, and just want to say bless you, Pastor.
Oh man, you know it's always good seeing you, Brother Will. Have you trying to make moves to get around this area?
Yes, sir.
Well, hallelujah, yes, sir. Glory to the King. It's always an honor, son. Always an honor. You know, coming down here, the tabernacle is a little bit different than when I meet you up in Canada with Brother Steve and them, because there ain't as many people up in Canada as it is down here, so I didn't get to say too much to you.
Yes, sir, I understand, Pastor. No, but I want to say that I'm the one who's honored to, you know, to have a man of Yah and men of Yah, the elders and teachers saying as well, and just to be, you know, under your leadership and just listening to all the teachings. I've been growing a lot, and I'm really grateful, Pastor.
All right. Well, bless you, Brother Will.
Well, bless you, sir, and I'll see you soon, Pastor.
All right. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
You know, Pastor Tatum has just got finished uploading the video. Everybody remembers Brother Mike from England. He does some very professional videos, DSLR, and he had two cameras up here, and you have to go check that out. I think it should be uploaded by now. Uploaded the video. It looks like a professional video. When Judah wakes up, I think Judah wakes up is the name of the song and stuff, but y'all will like that, what they've done. Now the world gonna think everybody's out there singing, but we know what it's about. But it's a pretty good video. Y'all need to go check it out. It's on Pastor Dow's YouTube page, all right? All right. Call number 540-540, Brother Freeman. This is Pastor Dow. How can I help you, son?
Shabbat Shalom, Pastor.
Hey, Shabbat Shalom, Brother Freeman. How can I help you?
Pastor, just calling in, Pastor, to say thank you for allowing me and my family on the land, and just want to tell everybody thank you. Thank you, Pastor. We had a great time. It was a wonderful time, and we're still energized from being on the land, Pastor. Eyes are peeled. It's like we're more keen. It's more we can see a lot clearly now that we left somewhere that's so peaceful.
Right.
But we can see a lot of things going on around us, and you know everything's not spirit, but hey, the way they're going now, we can. It just about seems like everything is spiritual, and we're looking at people and we see spirits on them. They're looking crazy out here in the world. And, man, Pastor, I mean, it just was a wonderful time. We had a wonderful time, Pastor, and we really appreciate the time that you allowed us to spend with you all, and we had a great time, Pastor.
Well, I'm glad because it's been an honor to meet you and to see you again.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. My family, they want to tell you something, of course.
Hold on.
Shabbat Shalom, love you.
Hey, Shabbat Shalom. I heard you about your testimony last night, Sister Bobby. Are you receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit? So that's beautiful.
Yes, sir. Bless you.
Bless you.
Hey, Pastor, we love y'all. We striving, Pastor. Glory to the King. We just love y'all, Pastor. We can't wait to see you again. So you just keep doing what you're doing. I know that you will.
Hey,
Pastor,
I want y'all to stay the course, man, because you know we got enemies, and y'all already know the enemies that we're praying against. And we always hear when y'all heard the Most High speaking to us. We need to actually, all of us Israel, we need to keep up the prayers against our enemies. We need to keep it up. Don't let up on it. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir. That is yes, sir. That's all I got to say about that. Thank you for saying that once again. And yes, sir, we definitely will.
All right. Shabbat shalom.
Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, Pastor.
All right, let's go to New York to Brother Cody. Call number 716-716. This is Pastor Dow. You're on Streaming Truth Radio broadcast. How can I help you, Brother Cody?
Shalom, my pastor. How are you doing, sir?
I'm blessed of the Most High Yah and highly favored, son.
Thank you. Right on, sir. Right on. I was just going to say a couple of things. I'll try to be as quick as possible. The first thing I was just going to say, if Brother Cody from Minnesota, I have no other way of getting hold of him, I found. Brother Cody from Minnesota, if you're listening, give me a call, please, if you have actually received my number. I'll appreciate it. Thank you. But no, Pastor, you know, I just wanted to, one of the things I really wanted to say was, again, thank you for allowing me to come on the land, and just seeing my true family, hallelujah, and also that thank you for the food. I thank the sisters, I thank the brethren for the just the labor and the growing of the food, because I came back home and it doesn't matter that I buy, you know, organic USDA whatever food, my body cannot get satisfied. It can't. It doesn't have the minerals and the nutrients in it that I experienced of the food on your land. And I thank the Most High. I thank Jesus for, you know, that having it so that y'all's hands are blessed in making that food. I thank you for letting me have some of that food. Thank you.
Well, you're welcome.
Yeah, thank you. The other thing I was going to say real quick was that I kind of felt it, like, just kind of hit me a while ago. I really want to say to just the people of Straightway, the people of Yisrael, and anyone else that's listening, when I talk to Pastor Dow, when I talk to Pastor Dow and the few times I have face-to-face briefly, I just want to say, you know, what we said, of course, is between us, but every time I talked to him, I was humbled, because it was not about him. It was not about him. It was about the ministry, and it was about the people. I just want to say that. And I thank you, Pastor, for humbling yourself, and I praise the Most High for that. Hallelujah.
Well,
that's all I got to say, sir.
Well, hallelujah. Bless you, Brother Cody. Thank you for the wonderful words. Shabbat shalom.
Bless you, sir. Shabbat shalom.
You know, my... I guess my heart, you know, many of you already know, but my heart is really, truly involved in the ministry of the Most High Yah. I'm very interested in saving souls, converting people's heart. And I do, you know, lives and stuff. The Holy Spirit, the Ruach, is the one that does it, but it sure does help when you have someone sitting in front of you, two or three or four, that is actually living this set apart life. It helps bring strength, because we can talk all day long about the word and stuff, but you're not going to be inspired to know how serious this word is until you actually see those who's living set apart. So I thank you for the wonderful words there, my brother. Brother Steve in New York, call number 347. Man, we have a lot of calls from New York today. That's good. Brother Steve, I can help you.
Shabbat shalom, my shepherd. Shabbat shalom.
Hey, Shabbat shalom, Brother Steve. How you doing up there, and how's the job going up there in that hospital?
Oh boy, I'm hanging in there, Pastor. Yeah. It's like once I get to the city, it's like these spirits just start to move. There's nothing compared to the peace of mind that's on the land. Literally, when I get off the highway, enter into the city, it's just, you see those demons moving, and even the thoughts that go through your head.
Ooh.
It's like, oh, I'm Mr. Len, and, you know, as you know, I work around these demons all the time, and the Father's really giving me the spirit to just take your time and study and labor so that when your time comes,
right,
you'll be ready.
That's true.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I want to first of all thank you, because I didn't get a chance to call last Friday because I was on the plane. There was delays, and I was in the air when the calls were going through. And thank you, Pastor, so much for allowing me onto the land and accepting me as your son, accepting me as, you know, your sheep. And I'm so honored to have you as a leader, my leader, a role model, and to show me how to be a man. Even though I grew up in, you know, with my father and all these people around me in the church, there's something about this ministry and there's something about your leadership that really teaches me personally where I fall short. And like I said, sometimes just listening to you, it rebukes me. Because it's like, damn, I need to get things right. So I know it's really the spirit in you that has worked through you and allows you to be who you are. And I just want to thank you for even allowing me into the fold.
Well, you're welcome, son. I mean, now, Bro Steve, you are, this was your first time to straightway. You're an educated man. I believe you're a registered nurse. And you grew up in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Do I have it right so far?
Yes, sir.
All right. So we have all that right. Okay. So now, you know, go ahead and give just a brief testimony of your experience being the first time here at a feast day at Straightway and your experience. Tell the world.
Wow. I can say there is no comparison to the Christian church to this ministry, because there's a certain spirit that just, the thing in religion where they just say, they speak. It's all mental assent. And then when you come to the land, it's the book is in front of you, especially the book of Acts. It's literally right in front of you, and the fruit is there. And even coming back to, you know, my house and talking to my family members, I see how the seeds I planted them. I tell my testimony to them. It hits them differently. Some people, it falls on rock and it doesn't even penetrate. Other people, it's like, wow, I want to learn more. And, compared to Christianity, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, they are stuck in tradition, stuck on understanding the Sabbath day, that's the Sabbath, and not even understanding the high and the low Sabbath, understanding the feast days. And they thirst and follow after Ellen G. White. And it's like, if they see you in the street, they'll first give you one of her books before they give you the scriptures. And I was like, it's such a religious and traditional spirit. And, you know, even when I got home, my father, he's the first elder of the church I grew up in, and even trying to hear me out on certain things about the religion and tell him about my testimony of the things that I saw, it was like falling on rock.
Wow.
There was no penetration there. And it was heartbreaking, because I know the truth is there, and I don't think people understand the remnant of the scripture is Straightway. Like, you are the Most High's battle ox. I don't think people understand what that means. And until you understand, you're just not going to get it. And that's it, Pastor. I can't say anymore. It's either you got it or you don't. You have the ears to hear or you don't. And it breaks my heart when the Father chooses some and not others. But hallelujah, no matter what.
All right, Brother Steve. Hey, appreciate the testimony there, brother. Hallelujah. You stay tuned and be at peace, all right?
Shabbat shalom, Pastor.
Shabbat shalom. That's Brother Steve. One thing unique about Brother Steve, I think Brother Steve is either close to or he studied right now to be a doctor. Sure is nice to have a doctor in the ministry, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it be nice to have one of them too? Glory to the King. Let's go to Covenant Community up at Brother Randy in Kentucky. Call number 856-856. This is Pastor Dow. You're on the Strictly Truth Radio broadcast. I can help you there, Brother Randy.
Shalom.
Hey, Shalom, Junior.
Shalom. Yes, sir. How you doing, Pastor? I'm doing incredible. How you doing, brother?
No, oh, we doing all right, Brother Junior. You know, our hand is to the plow.
Yes, sir. You hear me, Pastor?
I can hear you very well. Speak, say on. Okay,
I'm doing great, I'm doing beautiful, I'm enjoying myself, I have a wood stove now, I know how to use it now, so, I pay $0, it's been, in the north, you pay like, before, you pay $5 and up, it's crazy, you know what I'm saying, you save a lot of money. Getting done. People been doing this for 100 years, 1,000 years.
Right.
So people have complained back. You know what I'm saying? It's simple. It's simple. Things are very simple.
All right, Brother Junior. Good hearing from you.
I don't have much. So. Yes, I don't have much. So bless you, Pat. Bless you, Alvin. So,
Oh no, Shalom, Pastor. We're just all sitting here. The brother, Brother Ron, Brother Ruben, everybody sitting here just listening to the service. And after a hard week's work, just getting out here, getting it done, staying busy, staying productive, staying tired. But a blessing to hear your voice, a blessing to hear the services, and looking forward to Sabbath service in the morning.
Hey, you know, Brother Randy. Cold weather's coming in. It's going to hit y'all quicker than it is us. Are y'all ready?
Oh, we're ready. We got one more wood stove to install, and that'll be done this week, be it the Father's will.
Good.
And so all three stoves up and running. So, and we got plenty of wood. So we've been focusing on wood and stoves and insulation, and we've been doing some sheetrock. Brother Junior been working on sheetrock with Brother Ron today and getting that insulation in. And so we're just getting it done, just preparing for a hunkering down. And Brother Ruben getting it done. So we're all getting after it.
Well, hallelujah. You talking about Brother Ruben from Alabama?
Yeah, Brother Ruben from Alabama.
Ah, good. Glory to the King. Brother Ruben's getting a taste of the simple life up there.
It's reminding them of an earlier day.
Hallelujah. Glory to the King.
Shalom, Pastor.
All right. Shabbat Shalom, Saints. Love y'all dearly. King coming. Hallelujah. All right, let's go to Georgia. Elder Rufus. Call number 706-706. Hey, bless you, Elder. Pastor Dow. You're on Straightway Truth Radio broadcast. I can help you. Well,
Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom, Pastor.
Yeah, who is this?
This is a young man of Stateway, Georgia.
Okay, what you got, son?
This is Glover. I just wanted to say thank you for preaching, and I just wanted to say Shalom.
Well, you're welcome. Y'all keep praying for me then, okay?
Yes, sir.
All right.
So, Pastor.
Yeah.
I just thank the Father for giving me the Holy Spirit, this tabernacle.
You got the Holy Spirit, the tabernacles?
Yes, sir.
I remember that. You doing all right?
Yes, sir.
Well, glory to the King. Stay encouraged.
Yes, sir.
All right, bless you.
Bless you.
I tell you, isn't it wonderful when you're young like that, you receive the Holy Spirit? Man, I hope you can stay with it too, because it's getting more difficult even for grown people to stay with it today. It's a labor. It's a labor of love. Let's go to Florida. Caller number 786, Brother Alvin. This is Pastor Dow. You're on the Straight With You radio broadcast. How can I help you there, Brother Alvin?
Shabbat Shalom, Pastor. Shabbat Shalom. And Shabbat Shalom to the family and all the saints, Pastor.
Shabbat Shalom, Brother Alvin. Shabbat Shalom. Say on.
I just had a few questions. Actually, I got one question and just some, like, a comment. As I'm going to say, to most of the saints, like, people that are pretty much new like me, read the newsletters. The newsletters are awesome. Like, at least tell me if I'm wrong, but I think they'll give you a pretty much good understanding of what the principles of what Straightway believes in. Am I wrong or right?
Pretty much. It depends on, you know, what the newsletter is and the topic and stuff. A lot of times, the newsletters out there give out information. What you got?
Well, the one on head covering, I remember I was fitting on head coverings. I just, like, because from what I had read, basically, I know for sure the women had to read it while prophesizing or anything related to prayer or anything like that.
Yes.
But I wasn't 100% feeling it that they had to wear it all the time. When I read your newsletter on the head covering, you covered other parts that nobody else covered anywhere when I was looking around.
Right.
And I was like, wow, that's it. It's like, I feel 100% sure that women are supposed to wear head covering all the time, especially if they're married. They're supposed to wear them all the time. Like, that's it. I'm solid on that one right there. Yeah. And all thanks to the newsletter.
Well, you're welcome. You're welcome.
Thank you, Pastor, for real. Thank you, and thank you all the elders. I want to throw something at you, see what you think about this. I don't know if you ever heard, you know how Christianity has all these denominations and everybody understands everything wrong?
Yes.
Okay, do you think it might be the same with the Quran? Because, you know, the Muslims, there's a bunch of different denominations too. And I've been hearing some people say that they just misunderstand the Quran and it actually lines up with the Bible perfectly. I know you've been reading the Quran, so I don't know if you've actually seen some of that. I've read some of it, but I first need to get a solid foundation in the Bible completely before I tackle the Quran, you know?
Well, you got your hands full dealing with the Bible, because it's years before I even try to pick up with the Quran. But, you know, the problem, Brother Alvin, exists in all these religions in the world. Christianity is a basket of confusion. There are many sects of Christianity. There are many sects of Islam. There are many sects of Messianics. There are many sects of Hebrew Israelites. Seems like every time you turn around, everybody has their own sect of something. And that's why, you know, you're going to have to prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. And only you can be the one to do the proving of that. I can't do it for you. You have to get a clearance for your own self. You have to know in your own heart, knowing your own self, if you're following people of the truth. And, you know, no. It's just the way that it is, son.
So I'm with you, Pastor. Like, you're my pastor. I follow you guys out there because I know you've read some of it, so I wonder if you've been coming to somewhat the same conclusion or something, you know? That's all. I was just trying to pick your brain, see, like, if, you know, anything like that. Nothing negative or nothing like that.
Yes, sir. I understand.
Okay, that's it, Pastor.
All right.
Shabbat Shalom. Hello, everybody, and many blessings, Pastor.
Shabbat Shalom, Brother Alvin. Shabbat Shalom. Let's go back to New York to Brother Emmy. Brother Emmy, call number 347-347. It's Pastor Dow. You're on the Straight With You radio broadcast. How can I help you there, Brother Emmy?
Shabbat Shalom, Yisrael. Bless you, Ra'ah, Dow, Dan Yehuda.
Hallelujah. Shabbat Shalom, Ak. How can I help you?
Oh, Shepherd, I'm just doing good, excited, encouraged. Battlefield mind. And I just want to thank you, sir, for allowing me to break bread with you and the family of Straightway. And that's really all I have, Pastor, and that next be the Father's will next time I go down there, next Tabernacles, you know, if Father allows me to, if the Father invites me, which I believe His will is, if I stay the course, I'm gonna redeem myself from my singing, because, you know, I didn't have my voice.
Yes.
And I make sure I bring a lot of honey and a lot of lemons, just to make sure, you know, if I lose my voice from all the praise, I will redeem myself.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You did a good job.
Yes, sir. Bless you. Hey, bless you, Shepherd.
Hallelujah.
Shalom aleichem. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom, Brother Emmy. Glory to the King. Let's go to Florida. Call number 786-786, Brother D. Jerry. This is Pastor Dow. You're on Strictly Truth Radio broadcast. How can I help you there, Brother D. Jerry?
Shalom, 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 my pastor, and all of Israel. Bell Barachi, Pastor, how you feeling?
I'm doing all right. I'm doing fairly well. How can I help you?
Well, you help me in so many ways that even words cannot explain, Pastor. You know, I'm going to do my best to keep my words very short. But first and foremost, I wanted to let you guys know that we made it back to this wicked city safely, you know. Through all the trials on the way, we made it back safely, praise God. And I just wanted to give my testimony, you know, coming to this feast, you know, to the Feast of Tabernacles this year, it was really a refreshing for my spirit, you know, seeing all the wonderful things that was going on, you know what I'm saying? It's just, words can explain, you have to be there to witness this experience, you know what I'm saying? Being that Sister Carol was, you know, speaking in tongues and the Spirit giving utterance and the Father coming down to speak to us as an assembly, it was an awesome experience. I can't stop having experienced anything as such in my life, you know?
Well, hallelujah.
Very, very, very a great experience. Hallelujah. And thank you in all the straight way for inviting us to your home, treating us like family. You know, we take kindness in the world, you know what I'm saying? And it really gave us utterance and edification how we're supposed to be to one another, you know. So just thank you all, Pastor, and we hope to see y'all again real soon.
All right, Brother Jerry, you be encouraged, okay?
I will, Pastor. I got one more thing to do if you don't mind me going to Shafar.
No, go ahead. Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom. Glory to the King. All right, let's go to Indiana. Indiana, caller number 260. This is Pastor Dow. You're on the Strictly Truth Radio broadcast. How can I help you there in Indiana? Shalom.
Shalom.
Hey, who am I speaking with?
Shabbat shalom. This is Brother Samuel Miles. I've been fellowshipping with Pastor Tatum for a while, and I just wanted to make myself known. I haven't called in, and just want to say Shabbat shalom, Pastor. I just want to bless you for your preaching, your teaching, everything. It's just been a true blessing just to hear from a true man of God.
Well, you're welcome. Hallelujah. I'm glad you're fellowshipping with Pastor Tatum. You stay the course, okay?
Yes, sir, I will. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Anything else?
All right. No, just saying Shabbat shalom to you all. Blessings to you.
All right, my brother. Same to you. Shabbat shalom. It's good to get encouraging messages like it really truly is. Where we at? Let's go to Ohio. Call them 614-614. Brother Rashid. It's Pastor Dow. You on Strictly Truth Radio broadcast. How can help you there, Brother Rashid?
Shabbat shalom, Pastor. How you doing?
I'm doing well, son. What about you?
Pretty good. Hallelujah. Blessed by the Most High. Just wanted to get out here and thank you and thank the family for allowing me to, well, first of all, thank the Most High for allowing me to his feast. And thank you for allowing me into your gates, into your home, and into the homes, so I can keep the feast of the Most High, y'all. And just wanted to thank the sisters for the food. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor Dow, Pastor Tatum, Elder Austin, Elder Rufus, for the fire messages that came out of for the fire Torah portions. That's pretty much it. And, just wanted to give some recognition to Elias. I followed Elias around for about 4 or 5 days. That young man works. he's like a year younger than I am, or 2 years younger than I am, but I followed him around for about 5 days, and he works.
He sure does.
Kind of works.
He sure does.
So that's all I got, Pastor. Just want to say that. Thank you, Shabbat Shalom.
All right, my brother. Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. All right, let's go to New York, Brother Mike. 646-646. This is Pastor Dow. Universal Service Radio broadcast.
Shabbat
I can help you, brother.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. How you doing,
Shabbat,
son?
Shabbat Shalom. I'm just calling. I want to confirm that I got the Holy Spirit on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah. We heard about it.
I want to confirm that.
Yeah, everybody got the message.
Yes, I did. Yeah, it was an amazing feeling, Pastor. It was something I never felt before. I don't even know. For 27 years of my life, I don't know how I live without the Father. I don't ever want to live without Him again. I want to thank you, Pastor Corey, Brother Steve, Brother Emmy, Brother Lucius, Brother Freeman, Brother Tyree, Brother Will, and Brother Cody. They pushed me so hard to get the Holy Spirit. And the Father, Jesus Christ, just came down on me and said, "Son, it's time. It's time." And I was crying, and I was crying, and I was crying. And it was just something that I never felt before. And I don't ever want to lose it again. I'm not going nowhere. I am Hebrew, just like Brother Cody said. I am Hebrew, and I am beyond happy. It's just, I love speaking in tongues. I can't stop doing it. I can't stop doing it. I sing in it in the shower. I walk around doing it. The feeling, Pastor. Like, it's like I say to the Father, like, "Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for finally blessing me." He was searching my heart, and He was taking His time. He was waiting to the right moment, and He finally did it. And when He did it, He came to all my brothers, through you, Pastor, through Pastor Corey, and everybody just was pushing me and helping me through with their Holy Spirit. And I just want to thank everybody. I love all my brothers and all my sisters, and I would do anything for my family. Y'all are my family, and I just love all y'all. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Yah. Thank you, everyone. I got the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. All right, bro. Mike's good hearing it. All right. Love you dearly, man. You stay the course. You hear me?
Don't worry. I'm going to do whatever it takes, Pastor. Whatever it takes.
Hallelujah. Shabbat Shalom.
Hallelujah. Shabbat Shalom.
You know what? Let me go ahead. I knew we had quite a bit of testimonies. We'll go ahead and blow the trumpet for all the people that received the Holy Spirit during this week. There's a lot of people. And you know, God's really good. Really, really good. Really good. Really good. That's good. We're seeing all these new people being filled with the Holy Spirit, and some of you need to be refilled. And that's just the truth. Some of you need to be seeking to get refilled, so hopefully He can compel you to change your attitude. Glory to the King. Hallelujah. Let's go to Texas. Caller number 832-832. This is Pastor Dow. You're the Shabbat Shalom radio broadcast. I can help you there in Texas.
Shabbat Shalom, Pastor Dow. This is Brother Josiah Miles. I've been listening to you for about the last 4 years, sir. I fellowship with Brother Mitchell and Brother Gregory down in Houston.
Okay.
And I'm one of those that needed to be refilled, sir. I stepped out of the Christian church just about 4 months ago. I tried to implement Torah in there, try to implement and influence, and it didn't work out. It started to warp me, the Christian mindset. And I had stepped out, so right now I'm an over-the-road trucker, and I've been listening to you and then Pastor Tatum as examples to sharpen my iron. So I want to say thank you, sir.
Well, you're welcome. And you stay encouraged and stay the course and stay out of those churches.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right, my brother. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. I love everybody. Thank you very much again. Y'all have a good night. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. You know it's commanded, brothers and sisters, that you do not forsake the assembly together as the manner of some is. You know, it's become a mannerism where all these people today are these little bitty islands to themselves. And even though you can read throughout the scriptures that Israel was tribes and they were together, I told you, man, the way that they do the minds operate today, boy, so deceived. And you know what? And those people believe that the Most High is coming back just for them because they have a mouth profession coming off the edge of their tongue. Man, that's just utter deception. It really truly is. People just don't get it. Let's go to Texas, call number 281-281 of Brother Allen. This is Pastor Dow. You know, Sherry Richard Radio broadcast. How can I help you?
Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, pastors, elders. I was straight away. I'm just calling to say thank you for allowing me to come and fellowship at Tabernacles. I had a blast. I was only able to stay a couple of days, but the time I was there, I mentally enjoyed myself. And concerning your last comment, I couldn't agree more. Yeah. These island people, you know, mm-hmm. I just don't get either, Pastor. But anyway, yes, sir, I really enjoyed myself there at Tabernacles, and I just wanted to encourage you and straightway to stay the course. We love you guys, and we're looking to you for counsel and edification every week. And just Shabbat Shalom and bless you.
Hallelujah. Good air from Brother Allen. Shabbat Shalom. King come.
Yes, sir.
Let's go to Pennsylvania. Call number 215-215, Brother Tyree. This is Pastor Dow. You know, Shabbat 230 or broadcast. I can help you.
Shabbat Shalom, Shepherd. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hold on, Shepherd. Hold on, Shepherd. Children, can't wait to speak to you.
Shabbat Shalom.
Yes, sir. You should see their face. They can hear you. So, yes, sir. Pastor, I wanted to call in and actually thank you for doing the feast for every day. Actually, you know, putting up a video at 7. We really appreciate it. I really needed it. You know, I have a question I have to ask you. I was meditating on a book of Exodus today.
All right.
And I, you know, as I meditate on it, I'm like, man, Pastor, I'll be studying hard. Because a lot of the things I'll be meditating on out of it, I'll be seeing you do it. And actually, just listening, I'm like, wow, you really have to actually do a lot of studying. So I want to ask the question, how much studying do you do? And for me to have more, to be filled more, we all want more. And that's what it says, you want more. But, you know, you're like a sluggard. So from you know, you, can you tell me how it was for you when you first, in the beginning of your 20 years, how was it for you?
Oh, the beginning of it, man, that's all I did. And the majority, that was my pastime, period. I had the word around me all the time. I studied all the time. I had the Bible with me on my lunch breaks. Many times I would take my own lunch just so I could sit in the vehicle so I could just read the Bible. I did a lot of fasting, a lot of praying, a lot of reading of the scripture. I did a lot. And of course, when I get older and stuff, got more responsibility, especially in the community, I still study a lot. But I have to actually get up a little bit more earlier to spend time with the Father. And if there's anything I can tell any young man, the Bible says, whereof shall a young man cleanse his ways? And of course, them ways are by taking heed to the word of Yah. Young men, I want y'all to listen to me. Do not let anyone get in the way of your personal time with the King. Do you hear me? Not even yourself.
Yes, sir.
You cannot get those time, those days back. When you set yourself apart aside to spend some time with the King, set your family straight. Don't let them disturb you. You get about your Father's business, because if it wasn't for your set apartness with the Father and stuff, the family be all jacked up. All jacked up. And the Father comes before anybody.
Yes, sir. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Pastor. I also wanted to give a couple shout-outs. I don't want to leave anybody else. If I leave anybody out, please forgive me, saints. I love y'all. I want to give a shout-out to Brother Ron, Brother Randy, Brother Freeman. You know, I think I was thinking about Brother Ron the other day. You know, the first time I actually, when I was talking, when I talked to Brother Ron, it's probably like the fourth or fifth time he asked me, he said, Brother, have you received the baptism of the Holy Spirit since you believe? And when he said that, I was like, huh? I was like, I don't know. He's like, yeah, you go look at them teachings. And from that point on, right from that day on, I had received it. Because I felt so scared in my heart. Like, I do not want to lose the Father. I love him. I love his people. Because you really can see it through his people. I mean, you really can. If you see the people, you can really see the Father working through his people. And when you see that and you see the world, you're like, I don't want to be around these people. I don't want to be around death. I want to be around life. And, you know, I didn't even want to go to sleep. And he really encouraged me. And Brother Randy as well, too. I mean, he really encouraged me and let me know exactly how to do step by step by step to come out of this place. I live probably like 15 miles away from my physical mother, my fleshly mother. And since... You know, I've been following. I don't be around none of my physical family. I have one sister, a fleshly sister. She lives next door to me. And my mother haven't even seen my child yet. Shaul.
Wow. Yeah,
Saint seen Shaul. My mother haven't. My father haven't. You know, my father haven't either.
Why is that? Like that,
you know?
Why is that?
Huh?
Why is it that they haven't seen her? Seen him?
Oh, they don't come around. Or matter of fact, I get talked about.
You know, that's pretty sad, you know, Brother Tyree, because in the ministry, you're not the only one. But we got these heathen parents. You know, you think that they would be elated and excited about seeing grandchildren, and these people are so jacked up in the mind and so earthly, sensual, and devilish. What is it that will cause grandparents who are definitely without natural affection to not even want to see their own grandchildren? I mean, that is like the height and the sense of the zenith of being a parent, is to see your children have children. And nowadays, man, these people are so cold, so hard, so callous, so cruel. That's how you know that we're on the right path. That's how you know it.
Yes, sir.
Because they don't want nothing to do with us. And just think. We live in clean, live in holy, live in set apart, and these folks don't want nothing to do with us. Wow. Amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And Brother Scott.
Yes, sir.
Brother Scott, he's got a parents that they don't even profess Yah. They don't profess God. They believe in science and all this other stuff. And guess what? They have been here 2-3 times. Sister Angelica's parents have been here. And you check out Brother Scott and them. Brother Scott didn't grow up believing nothing, but yet his parents are some of the most kind-hearted, kindest, sweetest people you'd ever meet. I guess them the ones that the Bible says you make friends with unrighteous mammon, that they may receive you an everlasting habitation. Because those people, if you didn't know better, you were swapping down that they have the Holy Spirit, and the people who claim to have the Holy Spirit ain't got a lick of it. That's how jacked up things are.
Yes, sir.
But these people who profess that they are Christians and in the church and love y'all, they ain't worth a damn. They ain't worth nothing. Now, but go ahead, Brother Tyra. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I had to get those words in there, man. It's just a without natural affection. It just rings in my heart and mind.
Yes, sir. You know, the saints, you know, I every time I see that, though, within the fleshly family, I always think of the Father heart and their heart to make sure I stay away.
Yeah.
Because that's where the devil's at. I always think about that. Because I think about this every day when I wake up as a father, you know, because growing up in a place where you see nothing but death, murder, and family going crazy, you really, throughout that ass whooping, excuse my, you know, my language, just throughout that ass whooping, you really love the Father when you finally get to know that, oh, he's real, he came to save me from my wicked and nasty self, and I don't have to live like this. So you ain't trying to be around nobody that's condemning you and trying to bring up your past and everything. You're not trying to be around that. You really want to be holy. I mean, you just want to be holy. That's it.
Yeah.
That's all you want to do. And if the only way you can do it, you got to be away from people. That's what you got to do. It brings you peace. My sister said, yes, she said, I want to be like y'all. She said, because people talk about y'all, but she said, but I'll be looking at y'all. Y'all don't have no problems. I'm like, because we don't deal with nobody. You know, we live around y'all, but we not dealing with y'all. You know, I go to work, I probably see 100,000 people. I was just in New York today, sitting up on in the Bronx, 95 for an hour and a half, 5 miles. So crazy out there. And it's sad. It's just an ugly situation everywhere. But I see a lot of people. I don't talk to too many people. And I just pay attention to spirits all day long, just paying attention to it, because I know and I can see differently and I hear differently now. So I'm like, this is sick. And I had a friend of mine that used to be a friend, what I would call an earthly friend. And I had him ride with me yesterday, and I've been talking to him about the Father. First, he was very hard-hearted when I first started talking about it. Muslim, Salaam Alaikum, all the time, man. And I ain't trying to hear that, man. White people wrote that book. I ain't trying to hear none of that. So I prayed on him. I prayed against him. I said, you know, pray for his train wreck. He had a crazy train wreck and called me up. Yeah, man, this is going on, man. My baby mother is doing this to me. I said, well, look, let's read this. Let's read Ecclesiastes. Let's read Deuteronomy. And he was like, I'm about to leave my son and everything. So I read Deuteronomy and the husband that would leave his children. He said, wait a minute. Let me see that again. I said, read it. He read it. Now, how about this? He told me, he was listening to you in a truck ride to Baltimore. He was quiet the whole time. He was just sitting there like, and you seen the tears go in his eyes, you seen it all. He said, wait a minute, all these people be walking around cocky about the Bible, all these people just sitting around with the Bible all the time, and you telling me they know this, and they don't tell them. Oh, man, it's like when I first seen it, I'm like, oh, man, it's a beautiful sight, but it's a train wreck for some people.
Boy. Yeah.
It was for me as well, but it's a train wreck, and you see it. You're like, ooh, man. And, you know, trying to keep them, spirit down, you're like, oh, man. And, you know, he really had a train wreck in a truck with me. He really had a train wreck, and he really was like, yo, I just want to snap out. And I'm like, yeah, I know. It's a crazy situation. He's like, man, people know this? People got the Bible? Your cousin walk around with the Bible all the time, acting like he Mr. Super Christian. He don't know this? And because people want to be set free. You know, people have a lot of burdens and heavy, you know, demonic spirits. And people people need healing. And definitely, we need not just healing, we need casting out of devils. And people don't even know it's devils. They don't even know it's about anything about a devil. So to me, to actually let him listen to you and for the train wreck to come, I mean, it was a beautiful thing. I'm praying that he actually stays in this thing. But as I see myself in my walk, and as you what you was talking about, I don't mean to be so long, but as what you was talking about, as you came on, the Father always deal with me. Every time I hear you, it's something that I'm going through at that same time, and I'll be so happy that the Father is continually dealing with me. That's what I'd be happy about. Like, I'll get happy when I hear you say something, I'll say, oh, yeah, I've been dealing with that. Yep, the Father is dealing with me. So he's actually still working with me, keep, you know, and I don't want to keep getting reproof, but at the same time, I actually like it because I'm so messed up that I'll be crying all the time, like, please, Father, forgive me for being so messed up. I just don't know. I'd be so trying, but it's just so hard to go through this. And I'm like, no, it's not. Get your ass up and just do what you got to do. You know, and it's the rough road, but so what? It's better than death that's behind.
You're right about that, my brother.
So, yeah. You know, so I stay meditating. And I haven't went anywhere past. I was very quiet because I just learned to shut up and listen. For real, I was just shutting up and listening. And I ain't going nowhere. I don't like vomit too much anyway. I ain't eating no vomit. But at the end of the day, if I ain't got no hands or feet, I'm going to pray for the Father to keep me holding on to the rock. You know, if I ain't got nothing, I'm here. But Shabbat Shalom to all Yisrael. I do love all of Yisrael. Like I said, Brother Felix, my brother. Brother Felix, we're going to go see Brother Felix tomorrow. And yeah. I just want to get some of, I mean, the power. When I talked to Brother Mike and he received the Holy Spirit, I feel it off of him. I said, ooh, this is beautiful. And, you know, I can't wait to get down to see the saints tomorrow. We're going to, you know, Yah's will, we're going to be down tomorrow.
All right, my brother. Well, bless you.
Yes, sir. Bless you, too. Bless you, too, Pastor. All
right, Shabbat Shalom.
Bless all you right here. Shabbat Shalom.
This is Brother Tyree. Let's go to Sister Marjorie in Oregon. Call him a 541-541. This is Pastor Dow. You're on the Servitude Radio broadcast. How can I help you, Sister Marjorie?
Pastor Dow, thank you so much for taking my call.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a testimony.
All right.
My dad, a couple weeks ago or so, probably a couple weeks ago, he and I were really sick, but I went into his room and he was struggling, trying to get back on the bed. I'm like, what's going on? What are you doing? And he says, well, I was on my knees. I was on my knees to pray. It's really hard for him because he has, you know, the hip replacements, and one is a bad hip replacement that's been recalled, and of course there's nothing that can be done at his age.
Well, tell him to pray. Tell him to pray while he's sitting up, or praying while he's laying in the bed.
But he wanted to get down on his knees and pray.
Well, he can do it.
He did it. And then my son Joseph, he didn't want to have anything to do with anything. He heard you and he thought I was crazy and you were crazy and everybody's crazy that has to do anything with, you know, something that can't be proven. But last night my son got on his knees with me and asked for guidance from God to understand God in the name of our Messiah, Jesus Christ, his Savior and his King. And he said, Amen.
Well, hallelujah.
Now, these two men in my life, you know, when I first started listening to you, it was like, you know, they just thought I was out of my mind. But I just decided little by little to do as you say, you know. I did my part, you know, what a woman's supposed to do.
Yep.
I took care of them. I fed them. I washed the clothes. I folded their clothes. and so on and so forth. And they were taken care of. There wasn't anything they needed. They turned around and there it was.
Hallelujah.
And this has gone on for years. So now I think that seeing me go and I go get the groceries and I bring the groceries in because my son, there's another story, you know, but the fact that my son got down on his knees last night, I think is a big, big thing. And I'm sure that Yah will hear him because he knows his heart. And my son would not have done what he did if he didn't feel it in his heart.
Yep. Well, your example must be shining.
He just walked away and told me I was crazy. So I just wanted to share that with you.
Well, hallelujah.
Thank you so much for all the years of your patience of listening to me and all my questions and all my whatever. Because in my position, it's kind of hard, Pastor Dow, because it's been like, well, I want to put my dad to be the head of the house and, you know, call you and do that and my son call, and but it just wasn't going to happen, you know. And so I kept thinking, well, what am I supposed to do? I'm a woman with these two men that aren't ready. And Pastor Dow is saying that, you know, the men are supposed to do the talking. And meanwhile, I just little by little started, you know, even though you still hear from me, I really have tried to back off from bothering you because I know you're busy. But when things come up, I still come to you because I have no one to go to.
I understand, Sister Marjorie.
I have no one to go to, Pastor Dow, but you. And Sister Carol has been very, so patient and so wonderful because she takes my emails and then she does what she does, whatever she does.
Yeah, she tells me about every email that you're seeing.
And I just want to thank you for not telling me to go away and to, you know, stay away, don't call us, don't bother us. You never did that. So I thank you so much.
All right, my sister.
And my son and my dad, I think they're going to be okay.
Well, hallelujah. Stay the course and keep being an example.
I'm going to pass you now.
All right.
I just wanted to share that with you, and thank you again.
All right. Well, bless you, Sister Marjorie.
I have no one but you. I have Yah. I always talk to Yah, of course. But as far as a human man, pastor, and shepherd, and Jeremiah 3:15, you are it for me. Thank you.
All right, bless you, Sister Marjorie. Keep listening. You hear me? Shalom.
Shalom.
Glory to the King. Let's go to Georgia, call number 706-706. This is Pastor Dow. You're on the Straight With You, the radio broadcast. How can I help you there in Georgia?
Shalom, Pastor Dow.
Hey, shalom, Elder. Your name didn't come up. How you doing, Elder?
I'm good. I called from my cell phone. The young boys that called from the home phone. I actually got the same sentiment that Sister Martin had. I can't add to any other testimony that the saints have given about tabernacles. If you weren't there, you know, man, I feel bad that you weren't chosen to be a part of that experience.
Yeah.
You know, and even though even some that weren't there were still part of the experience that couldn't make it. But I tell you, I'm extremely grateful. Again, like I said, I can't add to the testimony because they've said it all. And you really, literally, truly had to be there to really feel the sentiment. And just what the Father did for us. We will grow from it. We will mature. Bless your elder Austin. I mean, I tell you, that message that that young brother brought was just, man, my. 100% on point. And,
good message.
We'll get it. We're going to get it. We're going to get it. And, but I'm in that same vein as Sister Margie. And I got gratitude in my heart. I'm thankful for your patience. I'm thankful for your long suffering. I'm very thankful that you really truly believe and trust in the scriptures, and your lifestyle shows it. I'm just thankful for it because you're living.
Oh, hallelujah.
We constantly see you encouraging them. Because a lot of times there's just not a lot of encouragement in Israel around you. And I mean, you get a little bit here, a little bit there, but I know it feels like you're talking things into a bag of holes a lot of times, but surrender, we'll get it. We will get it. And I just thank the Father that it don't discourage you. It makes you drive harder. And watching it, it's just something to marvel at, it's something to admire, and it actually hurts too, you know, because it makes you as an individual, as a man, really dig deep down inside, go to areas that you actually didn't know existed in.
Yeah.
You know, I'm grateful. I'm just very grateful. The videos you've been making, you've been after Tabernacle, you've been encouraging. I thank the Father, you know, he's made some moves down here in Georgia and put us in a different place where we can grow. That's a man's own experience down here. And, you know, I thank the Father for it. And, you know, we bought the material today. And we get started on the deck first day morning. And I'm excited about that. That's growth for us. We get an opportunity to learn, get an opportunity to grow, do some adding for the kingdom. And, you know, just apply some of the things that we've learned. It's been a slow Father. I'm calling the hand pastor with the spirit of gratitude, and I'm just extremely grateful for your stick-to-itiveness. I'm grateful for your trust in the Father, and just your sure will just know it never stops, and it's appreciated by me, and I thank you for it.
Oh, I'm not going to stop be the Father's will, at least until the breath go out of my body, but I've got hope. And I keep plowing against hope. But stay the course. Hallelujah, stay the course. There's, you know, the king, when he gave himself for us, he had an expected end. And his reward is going to be when he see all of us that overcome and those of us that persevered. It's going to be a great reward for him.
Yes. Yes. Hallelujah. I look forward to that day, too. We got so much further to go, but that day is definitely coming. We got to expect it in. We just got to stay the course and keep our hand on the plow and endure to the end. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, bless you, Pastor. I don't want to keep you. I'm definitely going to call and want to truly say thank you.
Well, you're welcome, Elder. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Bless you.
Man, that was a beauty. He's right. Elder Rufus was right, man. We had a wonderful tabernacle. We can't say enough about it. We just can't. It's just wonderful. Let's go to Iowa. Call number 515 to Brother Charles or Bud. 515. This is Pastor Dowell. You're on the Strictly Truth Radio broadcast. How can I help you?
Shabbat Shalom, Pastor.
Shabbat Shalom.
Well, I was just talking to Brother LaRon. And he wanted me to call in and share how the Lord delivered me from a semi-wreck that I pulled a woman out of.
Oh, really?
It was amazing. I don't know where to start, but yeah. So I see this truck, it flipped over on its side, me and a friend of mine, with the passenger door down, of course, and the driver door up in the air. And I ran over, and there was a woman standing there, and I said, is a driver out? She said, no. So I leaped up on top of it, and there's this small black woman curled up in the fetal position against the passenger window, and there's orange flames starting to leap up there, you know. Ooh. And so I locked the door up, and I jumped down in, and, well, I don't know, this part's more of my shame. I wasn't strong enough to lift her up being unconscious. I mean, I never realized how hard it is in that small of a place, you know. It's really small in the booth, and it may have been smashed a little bit because of the accident. I kind of had tunnel vision, but I lifted her twice, and then I couldn't get her up because she was between my legs. You know, I couldn't lift any more.
Right.
And I didn't want to set her down on the burning glass, so I stuck my leg under the glass, and I started crying out to her, "Baby, you're going to burn. You got to wake up." And anyway, I struggled, and I finally got her standing all the way up, and it took everything I had to get her standing up. And by now, all I can see is orange flames. The whole truck is just totally engulfed almost on the window side where the windshield is and the motor. And then my friend started yelling, "It's going to blow. It's going to blow." And I screamed out, "I can't do it by myself. I need help." And nobody was coming. You know what I mean? Nobody was coming. So I just tucked my head into her head, and I figured we were going to get blown up, you know, because I couldn't leave her. He's saying, "I got to get out." And it's like, I can't lift her. So the next thing I know, I don't remember lifting her, Pastor. It had to be the Father. I mean, up over my head, 8 foot in the air, I got her out the door. Like it was nothing. I don't even remember it. I don't remember it. It wasn't me. It wasn't me. But we jumped out. I handed her down to a friend. We made it 75 foot, and it blew up behind us. Like 90 seconds behind me. It blew up.
Wow. No greater love than this. Then a man laid down his life. In this case, you didn't even know her, but you was willing to lay down your life to do it, and the Father just helped you out, man. We glad that you got out of there safely. Man, I tell you, man, I bet she was happy too as well. Glory to the King.
Yes, she was. Yes, she was. Yeah. But it wasn't me.
Keep that the whole thing. I wasn't strong enough. I'm like, you know what I mean, a 50-year-old, 49-year-old, 150-pound guy, I couldn't do it. I mean, Father did it. It was all the Father.
I understand, my brother, but I tell you what, man, that's good that the strength kicked in and that both of you were able to get to safety. It really was.
It was so miraculous. I've never been to anything like that in my life where, yeah, there's no doubt I saved her life. And I let her know that she was a Hebrew Israelite. She needed to start acting like one, but I haven't seen no fruit yet. But she does listen very closely to me because she's really fond of me right now.
Yep, you're a hero.
Anyway.
You know that, right? You're a hero.
She seems to sure think so.
Yeah. What?
Yeah, well, yeah, the truth was I was closing my eyes thinking we were about to die and just hold her tight. That's how that worked.
Well, hallelujah. I understand, my brother. Believe you me, I comprehend very well, but, hey, I appreciate the testimony.
Just knowing that, you know, the Father's with us, no matter what it looks like, the Father is with us.
Glory to the King.
I won't keep you any long, Pastor, but Brother LaRon wanted me to share that, and I probably should have called in right when it happened. It's been 2 weeks, but anyway.
You're just a humble man, bro. That's all it is, just a humble man. Glad you're safe.
No, I didn't do it. Yes, sir.
All right, bless you, Brother Charles.
Bless you, Pastor.
Shabbat Shalom. I know exactly how you feel. I mean, I've been in quite a few of situations like that. Never had one. I had one close to where it seemed like it was going to blow up, but it didn't. But I tell you one thing, I've been in quite a few situations like that. They just let you know about, you know, I think this is the difference. I really truly do. Because even a total stranger, I remember just parking my vehicle, jumping out of it, and running over into the midst of danger. Not even caring about my own welfare and being, but just trying to get the other people to safety. I guess what that is that spiritually, you're really truly not concerned about your soul and where you're going when a breath go out of your body. And I guess that we have that blessed assurance that causes us to respond like that. Now, I do know naturally you'll get soldiers who don't even know y'all that would literally throw themselves on a grenade. That's because of training to save their comrades. But when you're out in the civilian world, I cannot tell you the hearts of these people is so cold and so cruel. You know, my story, I can just give you the recent stories. The stories in Cracker Barrel, this woman was sitting there, breath, life going out of her body. You got registered nurses just sitting there looking at her. Because the damn laws of this land says there could be a possible lawsuit against you. And rather than responding, you'd rather sit up there and keep your career and let somebody die when you have it in your power to do what you can to help deliver someone, and you care about some damn defiled laws of this wicked-ass land rather than... And think about it. You can't even do that which nature puts in you. That's pretty bad. The laws of this land will mess you up, just like religion will. We had some Amish up here some time ago in Kentucky, and they have a what you call a non-violent doctrine. And you had these thugs, these bastardized thugs, they would go over to this Amish community, about three men, they're calling boys, and they would beat this family and then rape this guy's daughter right in front of the father. And the father's praying to Jesus. Oh, help us, Jesus. Oh, and mind you, nonviolent. And his religion would not allow him to protect his daughter. That's what I keep telling you. These Christians, they something else, because they definitely are not Israelites. And some of you would have still behaved the same way if you never heard of me. And then to make things going from bad to worse, they came back a second time to do it again. And this man couldn't square his theology or his religion, and he literally went insane. Literally went insane. Now I tell you what I'd have done. I'd have went and got my trusty shotgun and I would have shot him in the face. That's exactly what I've done. And after I shot him in the face, I'd have cocked that shotgun and I'd put that shotgun on their private parts and I shot him there too. Exactly what I'd have done. And I'd make sure by the time it's all said and done, when it's time to call 911, there's one story that's being told. Mine. Because you're not going to come and threaten my family, rape my daughter, all that kids, and do all this evil and stuff and think that I'm going to sit up here. I'm praying to Jesus. I'm praying that he makes this trigger finger maintain its integrity throughout the trigger squeeze. And I'm praying that my sight is true. You better believe it. That's how I'm praying. The same Yah war, same one that teaches my hands to war. So your problem is your theology and your religion. So we live in a world now that people, even saints, will sit back and watch you die rather put themselves in harm's way to even try to deliver your soul. I'm telling you the truth. I am telling you the truth. I guess when all you have is your pathetic life and you haven't lived anything for the Father, I guess you got to eke out the next few days all you can while you can. I don't know. I just thought I'd throw some intrusive comments in here to penetrate. But hey, Sister Carol would tell you, and there's a lot of things I don't even never share with you. Sister Carol would tell you, I've been in a couple of them harm's way situations quite a few times in life. And the Most High has always delivered. Even when I was a heathen, he's always delivered. So I don't understand not helping people. My heart is just not built. I'm an Israelite. I'm a Hebrew. I just can't be cruel to people. Now, I can reprove. I can rebuke. If you're my enemy, I can be the best enemy you ever had. I promise you. But that only comes on the heels when you decided to be my enemy. Because I won't be going out here starting fights with people. I don't do that. But I promise you, you want me as an enemy? I promise you, you have the best one in the world. The best one. But an evil and adulterous generation always seek after a sign. The love of many is going to wax cold. We're just in a bad time, saints. We're just in a bad time and a bad situation. But we're in a good time for those of us who are looking for his return. While I'm thinking on this, do you know that yesterday is in the books? Do you know that today, when you shut your eyes, it's in the books? And you can't go back and undo all that you either done or didn't do. I told you, you better start listening and taking heed to my words, all of you. You better start living every single day as if it's your last. Because you look at Brother Charles, without any thought of his own life, he went into that cab to get that woman out of there. And Brother Charles had already counted his life out. He had already just grabbed the woman by the head and thought that he was getting ready to get blowed up with her. He didn't plan that day. Going out, seeing a tractor trailer turned over, flames around it and stuff. He didn't plan on him going out there rescuing a woman. And that night, or that day, he could have lost his life. What is your life but a vapor of mist? You're here, and then you're gone. Your life is like one drop of water in a sea. Your life, think about this, is not your own. If you're an Israelite, you don't have no life. And your life doesn't belong to you. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. And behold, all things become new. It would be nice if you can rehearse these sayings and these matters in your mind on a daily basis, because it would definitely help you sober up in how your treatment towards your fellow man would be. Because I'm telling you, every single one of us is going to be judged on our roles. You know, I'm a man of many hats. I'm going to be judged as a pastor. I'm going to be judged as a husband. I'm going to be judged as a father. I'm going to be judged as a brother. I'm going to be judged as a friend. Now, there's some things I'm not going to be judged as. I would never be judged as a wife. I would never be judged as a sister. Never. because it's not my role. You understand? But all them other hats, we're going to be judged by the words that are written down in those books. All of us are. Nobody getting by. It sure is sobering, isn't it? Bless you there, Brother Charles, but the Father seen that he was willing to lay down his life, and for a total stranger, he put himself in harm's way, getting ready to go off in eternity, and the angel of the Most High, who's always encamped around about them that fear him, performed a supernatural feat and delivered him. Got him out of that tractor trailer. After they got about 75 feet away, he says, the thing blew up. Ain't y'all good? Ain't y'all good? Not only is she rejoicing, but he is rejoicing. Because you know what? Brother Charles there an hour, he had just got an invitation of how short life is. He was right at death's door. And that's something for him to be able to lay down his life, and he, his heart must be in a good condition to be willing to go off into eternity and have no condemnation in his heart. What an Israelite, huh? What a beautiful Israelite. See y'all Shabbat morning. I bless each and every last one of you, sweet, precious, and strong. And victorious and mighty, overcoming name of our soon coming King, Yahshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. The King is coming.
Look at him looking.